So once again, welcome back. Today we are going to study about anticholinergic drugs. Last class we studied about cholinergic drugs. So these are the drugs which act against cholinergic drug, or they oppose the action of cholinergic drugs. So we will study about anticholinergic drugs and drugs that act on autonomic ganglia. These anticholinergic drugs, we can call them as muscarinic receptor antagonist, because we learned that cholinergic drugs acts on muscarinic receptors to produce their action. So these anticholinergic drugs antagonizes the action. So we can say that muscarinic receptor antagonist or atropinic drug, that is the other name for anticholinergic drug. They are also termed as parasympatholytic. So these are the drugs which block action of acetylcholine or cholinergic drugs. From the name itself, we can understand what is anticholinergic drugs. And they act by blocking the two receptors of cholinergic drugs, that is muscarinic or nicotinic receptors. So they block these two receptors. And these anticholinergic drugs, for the same reason itself, we can call them as antimuscarinic and antinicotinic. These antinicotinic ones are again classified into ganglion blockers, that is NN blocker, and neuromuscular blocker, that is NM blocker. If you haven't watched the cholinergic drugs video, please watch it and then come to this video. Atropine is the prototype of anticholinergic drugs. That is, we consider atropine as the model for all anticholinergic drugs. That's why anticholinergic drugs is otherwise termed as atropinic drugs. So this atropine is highly selective for muscarinic receptors. That is, we can be sure that whenever we give atropine, they will bind to muscarinic receptors to produce their antagonist action or antagonist activity. But their selectivity is low at very high dose. So if atropine is given at a very high dose, we can't be sure that they bind to muscarinic receptors to produce their antagonizing action. These anticholinergics are competitive antagonist, that is, they compete with acetylcholine for this muscarinic receptor site. Acetylcholine is the one that is the agonist, but atropine is the antagonist. So this atropine, they block the muscarinic receptor mediated action of acetylcholine on heart, CNS, smooth muscles, and exocrine glands. Now let us study about the classification of anticholinergic or atropinic drugs. They are classified into natural alkaloids, semi-synthetic derivatives, and synthetic compound. So first let us see what comes under natural alkaloids. Atropine and hyoscine comes under natural alkaloids class. And then semi-synthetic derivatives are homotropin, ipratropium bromide, and tiotropium bromide. Then third one is synthetic compounds. They are divided on the basis of their use. So the synthetic compounds that are used as midriatics are cyclopentolate and tropicamide, and anti-secretory and antispasmodic are propanthiolin, oxyphenonium, isopropamide, dicyclomine, and pyrimisulfid. These three are quaternary compounds, whereas dicyclomine and pyrimisulfid are tertiary amine. Now let us study about the pharmacological action of anticholinergic drugs. That is, what action they produce in the body. First one, the action produced by these anticholinergic drugs on CNS. Atropine is taken as a prototype. So we can say that these anticholinergic drugs or atropine has an overall CNS stimulant activity. But please note that at low doses, they produce peripheral effects only. Why? Because restricted entry into the brain due to the barrier. So at low doses, they won't be able to produce CNS stimulant activity. But hyoscine can produce central effects even at low doses. The high dose of atropine can cause certain side effects. They are restlessness, disorientation, hallucination, delirium, which is followed by respiratory depression and coma. So these are the side effects of anticholinergic drugs or atropine when high doses used. But hyoscine is the drug that can produce central effect even at low doses. This hyoscine drug is also used for its anti-motion sickness property in order to treat motion sickness. Next is action of anticholinergic drugs on cardiovascular system, heart. The prominent action is tachycardia, that is fast heart rate and heartbeat. Through the M2 receptors on SA node, vagal tone decreases the heart rate. So this anticholinergic drug counteracts that action by blockade of M2 receptors. Due to this blockade of M2 receptors, tachycardia occurs. But one point we have to note is that on intramuscular or subcutaneous injection, transient initial bradycardia often occurs. We learned that tachycardia is the prominent action, even though there is an initial bradycardia occurs for a short period of time when we give intramuscular or subcutaneous injection. Next is the pharmacological action of anticholinergics on eye. When atropine or anticholinergic drug is topically administered to the eye, it causes paralysis of the constrictor pupillae and paralysis of the ciliary muscle. Both this action is due to blockage of M3 receptors. And paralysis of constrictor pupillae will give rise to mydriasis, the condition mydriasis, that is where the pupil is dilated. That will happen, and here because of the paralysis of ciliary muscle, it leads to the loss of accommodation and cyclopegia occurs. That is, the patient will be having blurry vision of the nearby object. So that's the two condition that is caused by anticholinergic drugs on eye. Next is action of atropine on smooth muscles. Atropine relaxes all visceral, that is heart and liver, smooth muscles that receives parasympathetic nerve supply by the blockage of M3 receptors. And they act on the smooth muscles of bronchi and causes bronchodilation. And they have relaxant action on ureter and urinary bladder. And they act on glands. Next is their action on glands. They act on glands and decreases sweat. Salivary, tracheobronchial and lacrimal secretion will be decreased by the blockage of M3 receptor. As a result of this decrease in sweat and decrease in the secretions, following conditions happen, that is skin and eye become dry, talking and swallowing may be difficult. Now let us see the pharmacological effect of atropine on body temperature. It increases the body temperature at a high dose. And next pharmacological action is local anesthetic action. This atropine has mild anesthetic action on cornea. Next is uses of anticholinergic drugs. They are used as anti-secretory in pre-anesthetic medication, in peptic ulcer, and also to stop excessive sweating or salivation. In pre-anesthetic medication, they are administered prior to administration of general anesthetics like either in order to stop the increased salivary and tracheobronchial secretion. And they are also used in order to prevent vasovagal attack during anesthesia. Next one is in peptic ulcer. They decreases the gastric secretion and helps in symptomatic relief. Now they are superseded by H2 blockers. And they are also used as anti-secretory in Parkinsonism in order to stop excessive sweating or salivation that happens. Next use is as antispasmodic. In intestinal and renal colic and abdominal cramps, we use antispasmodic to provide symptomatic relief if there is no mechanical obstruction. Colic means pain, severe pain. And next one is they are used as antispasmodic to treat spastic constipation and irritable bowel syndrome. Next is their use as mitriatic and cycloplegic. They are used for diagnostic as well as therapeutic purpose. In diagnostic, they are used as mitriatic and cycloplegic property is made use to test error of refraction, and the drug used is tropicamide. And to treat therapeutic purposes, to treat iritis, choroiditis, iridocyclitis, keratitis, and a corneal ulcer. Next is central action. They are used to treat mild cases of Parkinsonism in extrapyramidal symptoms and also as an adjuvant to levodopa. Next is they are used to treat motion sickness, and hyoscine is the drug that is most effective for motion sickness, and they act centrally in order to produce the action. Fifth one is to antagonize muscarinic effects of drugs and poisonous. This atropine is specific antidote for anticholinesterase and early mushroom poisoning, and also they block the action of neostigmine that is used for myasthenia gravis, decuralization, and cobra envenomation. So these are the uses of anticholinergic drugs. Now let us see some of the adverse effects of anticholinergic drugs. They are dilated pupil, photophobia, respiratory depression, and constipation. So we have completed with anticholinergic drugs, and next small topic is drugs acting on autonomic ganglia. So what is this autonomic ganglia? This autonomic ganglia is group of nerve cell bodies in the autonomic nervous system. And autonomic ganglia is of two types, sympathetic and parasympathetic. So acetylcholine is the primary excitatory neurotransmitter in both sympathetic and parasympathetic ganglia. And the dominant receptor in ganglionic cells are nicotinic NN receptor. And it also has muscarinic M1, M2, adrenergic, dopaminergic, amino acid, and a peptidergic receptor. But the primary or the dominant receptor is nicotinic NN receptor. Drugs can either block or stimulate ganglia. So the drugs can be classified into ganglionic stimulant and ganglionic blocking agent. So first let us see what are the drugs under ganglionic stimulant. This ganglionic stimulant can again be subdivided into selective nicotinic agonist and non-selective muscarinic agonist. So the selective nicotinic agonist are nicotin, then lobelin, dimethylphenylpiperacillin, which is also termed as DMPP, and then tetramethylammonium, TMA. So these are the ganglionic stimulants which come under the class selective nicotinic agonist. And next one is non-selective muscarinic agonist, which includes drugs like acetylcholine, carbachol, pilocarpine, and anticholinesterases. Next one is ganglionic blocking agents. They are also divided into two types, like competitive blockers and persistent depolarizing blockers. So competitive blockers are hexamethonium and pentolinium. And these two comes under the class quaternary ammonium compounds. And next one is mecamelamine and pembidine. They comes under the class tertiary or secondary amines. And next one is persistent depolarizing blockers. They are nicotin and anticholinesterase. When given in large dose, they are persistent depolarizing blockers. And the competitive ganglion blockers were used in 1950s for hypertension and peptic ulcer. But now they are totally replaced because they produce number of intolerable side effects. And at present, there is no clinical relevance of ganglionic blockers. Thank you. Thank you for watching. We will meet in the next class. Bye.